With breaking news out of Canberra, where the Prime Minister has just spoken following the first National Cabinet meeting, where there was a focus on power and health. Take a listen.
There was a focus, of course, on the response to the health pandemic, which we know is ongoing. And in recognition of the pressure that health and hospitals continue to be under, the Commonwealth has agreed to extend the COVID funding arrangements until the 30th of December this year. There are some arrangements in place as well about some of the measures not being continued beyond September because it was agreed that they were not necessary.
Let's go straight to politics reporter Jonathan Kersley. Good morning, Jono. What can you tell us?
Yeah, interesting. First National Cabinet from Anthony Albanese. Health funding very clearly at the top of the agenda. State and territory leaders were pushing for a greater share of the cash. They've been meeting here at Parliament House around about 3 hours worth of talks. Now, during COVID, the public hospital funding was increased to a 50-50 split, but that did expire in September. As you heard the Prime Minister say just moments ago, that has been extended to December. That will cost $760 million. State and territory leaders also want more GP and improved access to health services. Anthony Albanese has addressed some of those issues this morning, but there's also the very serious crisis right now on the energy front and how state and federal governments can ensure there is enough supply in the grid to keep the country's lights on. Leaders stress they are letting their energy ministers deal with this, but it is a responsibility for all of them. Australia has ageing coal-fired power stations that in some cases have gone offline, but today coal and gas have been making up more than 60% of the fuel mix, powering the country, while wind right now is just 2% of the fuel load. Here's what the Prime Minister had to say earlier about the energy system.
What I can't do is stand here, Ali, and say that a new coal-fired power station or a new power station powered by any form of energy can be built in the next week, because that's not what occurs. We're suffering here as well from the fact that the transmission, the grid, isn't fit for purpose. So you have energy being produced that isn't able to be stored.
And in a week where a number of states have had warnings about power supply and the possibility of blackouts, the only immediate solution in the short-term crisis appears to be to keep more gas on shore or fix ailing generators and get them back online and keep the lights on. For now, on the energy front, the leaders have just agreed to continue working on a solution.
OK, Jono, thank you. Well, the energy crisis is intensifying in New South Wales with Treasurer and Energy Minister Matt Keane given emergency powers. Chris O'Keefe joins me on the desk. Good morning to you, Chris. What does this all mean? And is there a chance we could still see blackouts?
They're saying no to blackouts at this point, but with the situation is fluid and they really are just trying to get a handle on things as things progress day to day. But what they're thinking right now is that the Treasurer Matt Keane and the Energy Minister essentially went to the New South Wales Governor and said, we need emergency powers to direct coal mines to not export the coal, but to direct that coal to coal-fired power stations if that is necessary. So there is no suggestion at the moment that that lever will be pulled immediately, but these powers are precautionary and they are in the kit bag if and when they do need to be used. Now, we do know that we export a lot of coal in New South Wales, and if we get into a situation where that more coal is going overseas than is being used when it is needed in Australia, that is when the New South Wales government will use that now legislative power to direct the coal mines to put that coal into the coal-fired power stations to ensure we can keep the lights on in this state.
AEMO have told us that the conditions in our energy system are much better. We've seen problems in Queensland, we've seen problems in South Australia, we've seen problems in Victoria, and we've also seen problems in New South Wales. AEMO have described the energy situation as much healthier.
Now, the reason it is much healthier is that Bayswater Power Station in Musselbrook in the Hunter Valley, it only had one of its generators going or its operations going at the moment as a result of some maintenance and some issues that they had to deal with there. There are now two more of those generators back on, so three of the four are running at the moment. And Amber, they do believe that is enough power to get us through the next few days. And of course, the weather's warming up a touch too, so that makes things
sure
a little
is.
Easier.
Okay, Chris, thank you. Well, we can reveal some shocking allegations this morning in relation to assault charges levelled at William Tyrrell's foster parents. Police allege the foster mother kicked a girl, causing her pain and bruising, while the foster father is accused of grabbing the girl's neck. The pair were charged in relation to the alleged assault of the girl in November last year and have pleaded not guilty. A man is today facing charges for a carjacking assault in Sydney's inner south, accused of forcing a driver out of his car before speeding away. The 38-year-old was allegedly fleeing the scene of a car crash in Mascot, quick to desert his own car after police were called. Fire has destroyed a home at Hazelbrook in the Blue Mountains overnight. Bianca Bolzar has more.
As you can see, there is quite a lot for investigators to look through here as they determine just what caused this Hazelbrook home to burn down overnight. It took 36 firefighters to bring the unruly blaze under control, first getting called here at 6 p.m. The fire was fueled by piles of items stacked up around the single-storey property, including fridges, furniture and polystyrene boxes. Now, fortunately, the 79-year-old man who lives at the home was able to get out without needing assistance. Five other people in neighbouring homes needed to evacuate as well as a precaution.
It was just fierce. It was sort of terrifying. It looked like it was blowing wind because every window had all these big flames coming out of it. But it was just something that I thought, well, we'll go next.
This morning, the home is charred through. Hardly anything is salvageable. Investigators are scanning their way through the piles, also using a drone to get a better understanding of just how it happened.
A new subvariant of the Omicron strain is dominating New South Wales COVID-19 infections. Experts warning it could trigger a wave of cases. Infections from the BA5 subvariant have tripled since the start of this month compared to the most prevalent strain of BA2, which peaked around March. It comes as millions of Australians are overdue for their booster and are being urged to get vaccinated. The Australian stock market has taken a dive on opening today. The ASX 200 down 149 points or 2.27%. The All Ords dropping 156 points, that's 2.31%. The tech sector has taken the biggest hits, following by mining stocks. It has been a very rocky week for shareholders, with tens of billions of dollars wiped off the market on Tuesday. A young woman is in a serious condition following a hit and run in Melbourne last night. The 21-year-old was crossing Leakes Road at Tarneet around 5:45 p.m. when she was struck by a white sedan, the driver fleeing the scene. Another driver stopped to help the woman before she was taken to hospital. Anyone with dash cam vision or who was in the area at the time is being urged to come forward. A Queensland couple who lost their son in an horrific Australia Day crash are pushing for an overhaul of the state's juvenile justice system. Live now to Tim Avia. Tim, the Attorney General is launching an appeal against the sentence.
That's right, Amber. For those people who aren't familiar with the background of this case, it involves a 17-year-old criminal who was out on bail. He got in a stolen car while drunk and high, was speeding, running red lights when he crashed into a young couple, Matthew Field and Kate Ledbetter, killing them while they were walking their dogs and also their unborn child, who was going to be called Miles. Matthew Field's parents, Russell and Anne, have launched an appeal after that 17-year-old was handed last week a 10-year jail sentence, one in which, though, he could be out in just 6 years. Now, they have launched an appeal for that sentence to be appealed, and that is happening. The Queensland Attorney General says that is going to happen. However, what they really want is stronger laws as well, and this is their appeal today to the Queensland Government.
If the law says that individuals who carry out offences like this get 6 years, then change the law.
Now, a petition calling for the sentence to be appealed and also calling for law reform has now reached more than 50,000 signatures, and the families of the victims are asking the Premier, Anastasia Palaszczuk, to step in and take action.
OK, Amber. Tim, thank you.